Hello everyone. Today we are going to talk about cross hedging. What is cross hedging? Cross hedging is using one asset for hedging the transactions involving other asset. As I had mentioned in the last lecture, this is mainly used when futures may not be available for the actual asset of interest. And the example I had given was say airlines. So airlines are going to need jet fuel continuously, but jet fuel futures may not necessarily be available. However, crude oil futures may be available. So because movement in the prices of crude oil and movement in the prices of jet fuel is going to be more or less in the similar direction. And in fact, the magnitude will also be more or less similar. The percentage. Hence, people may use crude oil futures for hedging their transactions involving jet fuels. Now, what is the problem with cross hedging? See, in the usual hedging, what we saw is, so at time zero, you enter into say short hedge, okay, for selling something with futures price F1. And here in between you have to sell. Then what you did was, okay, so you sold at a market price S2 and you entered into a long position in futures contract with F2 as the futures price. And then here the opposite trades happened because of the futures contracts, two futures contracts. Now when doing this, because your futures and the initial contract were on the same asset, the quantity of that asset remained the same. So suppose you have, so here you have taken short position for buying say 100 tons of iron, then here you take long position, suppose here you have taken short position for selling 100 tons of iron, then here you take long position for selling same, that is 100 tons of iron, because the actual thing that you need to buy is also 100 tons of iron. So when you have only one commodity or asset involved, the quantity remains same throughout. However, now when you are talking about cross hedging, so for say jet fuel and crude oil, you may not want the quantities to be exactly same. Why? Because the prices are going to be different. The price of crude oil is of course going to be less than the price of final jet fuel. Hence, the quantities may not match. So you may need to adjust quantities in such a way that the losses and profits are getting properly compensated. Okay. Hence, we need a concept called as hedge ratio. And that's why cross hedging is different than usual hedging. So what is the concept of hedge ratio? What is hedge ratio? Hedge ratio is size of the position in futures contract. Size of the position in futures contract divided by size of the exposure. What do I mean by these? So size of the exposure means actually the quantity which you want to buy or sell of the asset that you are interested in. So if you are talking about airlines and jet fuel, then size of the exposure would mean actually how many liters of jet fuel they are interested in buying. Okay. And size of the position in futures contract means how many liters of crude oil should we buy or sell in futures to compensate for the losses in this. Okay, so this is for futures contract and this is for the actual asset in which you are interested. Okay, why is it called as exposure? Because you are exposed to a risk because of that transaction. Hence it is known as size of the exposure. Okay, so this is the hedge ratio, and of course we want to decide what is the optimal hedge ratio. Okay, in what sense optimal, we'll see after some time. So we need to decide the ratio which would give us the best possible outcome. Okay. So what is meant by optimal hedge ratio. So optimal hedge ratio we know is hedger, what is hedger interested in doing? Hedger is always interested in minimizing the risk, correct? Hedger is interested in minimizing the risk, and risk is there because of the uncertainty. So reducing uncertainty would reduce the risk. Okay, so optimal hedge ratio would be that ratio which minimizes the variance of the value of the hedged position. Optimal hedge ratio minimizes the variance of the value of the hedged position. Because if the variance is minimized, then the uncertainty is minimized and hence the risk is minimized. Okay. Now we need to derive what is the optimal ratio. So let us introduce some notations and then we'll do the derivation. So let delta S be change in the spot price during spot price of the asset in which you are interested, of course, of the asset in which you are interested during the life of the hedge. Okay, life of the hedge means, so you set up a hedge for say 3 months or 6 months, that period. Okay, so change in the spot price of the asset in which you are interested during the life of the hedge. Similarly, delta F is change in the futures price, but the futures price is for the asset which you actually use for hedging. So delta S would be change in the jet fuel prices, whereas delta F would be change in the futures prices for crude oil. Okay, change in the future price of the asset used for hedging again during the life of the hedge. Okay, so these are delta S and delta F. Now we need to talk about their variances, because finally we want to minimize variance of something. So sigma S is suppose standard deviation of delta S, and sigma F is standard deviation of delta F. Please note that sigma S and sigma F are standard deviations of delta S and delta F, not original S and F. Okay. And rho be correlation between delta S and delta F. Okay. So rho is correlation between delta S and delta F. And the optimal hedge ratio, let us denote by H star. We are going to derive value of H star. Okay. So H star is the optimal hedge ratio. Further, NA is the number of units that we need to sell of the asset. Number of units that we need to sell at some time point T2 between 0 to T. Okay, so NA is the number of units that we need to sell at some time point between 0 to T, and for that we are doing the hedging. Okay, and NF be the number of futures. NF be the number of futures used for hedging. So we have to decide H as NF upon NA. right? We have to decide optimal value of NF upon NA. Now, of course, NA is known to you. How many units of the asset you expect to sell, that is known to you. So the only question is deciding optimal H so that we can get optimal NF. Okay. Now we are going to use the derivation, I mean the basis risk, etc. that we derived yesterday in the earlier lecture. So we have 0 here, T here. At some point in between, we would be selling the asset. So the asset would be sold at price S2. We'll be selling any units of the asset at price S2. We would have initially entered into a short position in futures with price F1 and a number of units NF. And here we would enter into a long position in futures with again number of units NF and price F2. So what would be the payoff? Okay, the total payoff from all these transactions would be, so by selling NA units at S2, we get NA into S2. Now remember, we are again ignoring the interest because it's going to be small. And at capital T, I have a short position in futures, this futures, so I get F1 from that. And by the long position, I lose F2, and this is on NF units. Okay, so this is the total payoff. So let us try to make some adjustments. So this is S2 NA. Let me bring in S1 NA. So I subtract and add S1 NA. Why we are doing that? Because we know something about delta S and delta F. So we know variance of delta S, we know variance of delta F, and we know correlation between delta S and delta F. So, and we don't know anything about simply S2 or S1. Hence, we need to bring in delta S. So to bring in delta S, I need to subtract S1. Okay, so I have S2 minus S1 into NA plus F1 minus F2 into NF plus S1 NA. Okay, so this is delta S NA minus delta F NF plus S1 NA. Okay, and we know that NF is H times NA. That is how we have defined H. Let me go back. Where is it? Yeah, here. NF is H times NA. So let us substitute that. So we have delta S NA minus delta F H times NA plus S1 NA. So we have delta S minus H delta F NA plus S1 NA. Okay. So this is our total payoff, and we need to actually minimize the risk, means we need to reduce the uncertainty in the payoff. We need to know the payoff as accurately as possible. Okay, so if I want to reduce variance of this payoff, I need to reduce variance of this quantity, because this is anyway known. NA is known and S1 is the initial price, so that is of course known. So to reduce uncertainty, we need to minimize variance of only the first term, and even in the first term NA is known, so basically variance of only this bracket. So we need to minimize the variance of delta S minus H delta F. Okay, we don't need to worry about any other term. So how do we minimize this variance? So let us first compute the variance. So variance of delta S minus H delta F would be variance of delta S plus H square variance of delta F, because hedge ratio is not random, right? Minus 2H covariance of delta S delta f. Okay, I am using our usual variance formula, nothing else. Variance of delta s is sigma s square, this is sigma f square minus 2h. Covariance will be rho times sigma s sigma f, right? Correlation into the standard deviations. Okay, so this we need to minimize. So how, and minimize with respect to what? Minimize with respect to h, because we need to choose h, the hedge ratio, in such a way that this variance is minimized. So how do we do that? We resort to your usual calculus technique. So let me call this, say, v. So we differentiate v with respect to h and equate that derivative to 0 and check the sign of the second derivative. So from here we would get 2h sigma f, because first term is free from h. Second term becomes 2h sigma f minus 2 rho sigma s sigma f. Okay. Dy by 2v by dy by h square would be 2 sigma f, which is positive. Okay. Sigma f square. Okay, I've forgotten square. Okay. So, 2 sigma f square, which is positive. As a result, this equating this to 0 would give us minima. So, what is this? So, this turns out to be h sigma square f is same as rho sigma s sigma f. So, h is actually rho sigma s upon sigma f. Am I right? So, the optimal hedge ratio is given by this equation, rho sigma s upon sigma f. So, optimal hedge ratio depends on the correlation between the two things, two assets, movement, correlation between the price changes of the two assets and the individual variances. Okay. So, in fact, we can slightly reframe this, you know, to bring it in a more familiar form. So, I could write h star as rho sigma s sigma f upon sigma f square. Why? Because this is now covariance between delta s delta f upon variance of delta f. So, this is again similar to our regression estimate of slope. Okay. So, optimal hedge ratio is the slope of the regression line when we regress delta s upon delta f. Okay, because delta f is like a regressor, it's coming in the denominator. Okay, so optimal regression line is like the slope of a regression line when we regress delta s upon delta f. Okay, you can easily see what happens if rho is 1 and sigma s is sigma f. Means, suppose we are not doing cross hedging, suppose we are hedging using the same asset, then in that case rho would be 1 and sigma s would be same as sigma f. So h star would actually be 1. So you would be using same units, same number of units. Okay. And what happens if variance of one is less than the other? So if say sigma f is twice of sigma s, means if the futures are more volatile, then what should be our optimal hedge ratio? If futures are less volatile, then what should be our optimal hedge ratio? We can simply plug in some values and get this. Okay. So let me stop here. Thank you.